subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
People have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course, we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to.
Hello, viewers. I'm your host, Uzma Jafri, with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show with India, which has started a multi-nation vaccine export program in its neighborhood. Bhutan, Nepal, Bangladesh and the Maldives have already received the first shipment. Others are waiting for regulatory clearances and will be getting the vaccine soon. While New Delhi has rolled out world's biggest immunization program, it says it will help even the poorest of nations in accessing the vaccine and carrying out inoculation.
In just 5 days into the launch of world's biggest immunization program, India dispatched 150,000 COVID-19 vaccines to its neighbor and perennial ally, Bhutan. 5 more countries, including the Maldives, Bangladesh, Nepal, Myanmar, and Seychelles, received hundreds of thousands of shots in following 2 days. Many low- and middle-income countries are relying on India, the world's biggest vaccine maker, for supplies to start COVID-19 immunization programs and bring an end to their outbreaks. The vaccine development in India, popularly known as the pharmacy of the world, was being observed closely ever since the outbreak spread out of its origins in China and snowballed into one of the deadliest pandemics the world has witnessed. While its small neighbors are expected to immunize their countries entirely with the help of Indian manufacturing capacity, others are looking to procure a major chunk of their requirements from New Delhi.
हामीले नेपालको धरतीमा भ्याक्सिन उतार्न सफल भयो। यसको लागि म भारत सरकार प्रधानमन्त्री माननीय नरेन्द्र मोदी ज्यू र भारतीय जनतालाई नेपाल सरकारको तर्फबाट हाम्रा प्रधानमन्त्री सम्माननीय केपी शर्मा ओली ज्यूको तर्फबाट र नेपाली जनताको तर्फबाट म धन्यवाद दिन चाहन्छु।
India has been instrumental in the global fight against the coronavirus. To say it has done the most won't be an overstatement. From hydroxychloroquine to diagnostic kits, India supplied everything that countries fell short of in fighting the pandemic. Earlier in the month, India authorized 2 locally manufactured vaccines for emergency use at home. One licensed from Oxford University and AstraZeneca, and another developed at home by Bharat Biotech in partnership with the state-run Indian Council of Medical Research. Both the vaccines have thus far been proven safe, as barring a handful who developed minor side effects only to subside on their own after a few hours, the results have been encouraging. The government has reported hospitalization from side effects in only 0.002% of vaccine recipients.
कोविड के टीकाकरण से संबंधित 447 AFIs रिपोर्ट हुई हैं और उनमें से केवल 3 को अस्पताल में भर्ती कराना पड़ा और उन 3 में से भी 1 जो नॉर्दर्न रेलवे हॉस्पिटल दिल्ली में भर्ती हुए थे उन्हें डिस्चार्ज किया जा चुका है। इसी प्रकार दूसरे जो हमारे एम्स दिल्ली में भर्ती हुए थे उन्हें भी डिस्चार्ज किया जा चुका है और एक जो तीसरे एम्स ऋषिकेश में हैं वो है अस्पताल में और उनकी स्थिति अच्छी है, बेहतर है।
At least two other vaccines are expected to be authorized by India in the next few months. Meanwhile, the country will also be making commercial exports to Brazil and Morocco. India, which supplies around 1.5 billion vaccine doses to 150 countries around the world every year, is also considering using its robust logistic net to deliver the vaccines in all corners of the world. The plan is to not just save Indians, but the entire humanity. Indian vaccines not requiring a severely low temperature for storage has also made many countries turn towards India. As per reports, India might receive dozens of international orders in coming weeks. Observers believe it's an opportunity to expand its soft power considerably. However, New Delhi has shown it time and again that it doesn't commit to earn brownie points or strategic favors. New Delhi's endeavors are always in the interest of human development and global prosperity.
Moving on. As US witnesses a transfer of power at the top, its geopolitical engagements and alliances are expected to receive fresh directions. However, uncertainty looms over peace process in Afghanistan, over which course next administration is going to pursue. The common Afghans feel that the peace process, which is becoming frustrating owing to its long breaks and little output, can be brought back on track by US President Biden, but the new Washington dispensation, which is undoing major decisions of Donald Trump, is yet to take a call that has grown into an enormous challenge.
As soon as Joe Biden took the reins of American presidency, he reversed a number of decisions taken under the previous dispensation of Donald Trump. The reversal included government's intent of rejoining the Paris Agreement, World Health Organization, and stopping the construction of a border wall. However, this has sent some tangled signals to the observers and people in Afghanistan, where the peace process that was initiated and brokered by Washington and had secured some success hangs in balance. Some believe that Biden might restore the higher troop presence in Afghanistan, which has not recorded any significant shirking in violence since a deal was signed between the Taliban and the US in last February. The Afghan residents, however, are hopeful that peace process will continue to pursue with a positive and vigorous intent. They have urged President Biden to put pressure on the Taliban and the Afghan government to make peace.
ما چیز رو نمیخوایم که تمام همه چیز به دولت افغانستان برسه. ما اینو نمیخوایم که همه منفعت ها به مردم به طالبا برسه. ما اینو میخوایم که از طریق گفتگوها، از طریق فشارهای لازم سیاسی، فشارهای معقول سیاسی، فشارهای غیر معقول نه، همگی به صلح وادار شو. وقتی فشارهای معقول وارد میشه به خاطر ازیسته که مردم طالبایی که دو طرف هستن روز میشه که به می قانع میشن بالاخره هر چیزی که از رای معقول به دست آورد نتیجه درست میده. دیگه از آقای جو بایدن اینو میخوایم که از طریق فشارهای درست، فشارهای معقول سیاسی، گفتگوهای درست سیاسی با مردم افغانستان در مسئله سال افغانستان کمک کنند.
Rising violence has complicated US brokered peace talks taking place in Doha as Washington withdraws troops. The number of US troops in Afghanistan has been reduced to 2,500, the lowest level of American forces there since 2001. But the casualties are on an all-time high. US President Joe Biden has given few clues on what his plans are for Afghanistan. However, one option could be to leave a small counter-terrorism force in the country where its former Taliban rulers, Al-Qaeda and the Islamic State militant groups still have significant presence.
تقاضای ما من حیث یک جوان افغان یک محصول که جوان من حیث یک جوان افغان از رئیس جمهور جدید امریکایی است که اگر اینا نیروهای خود از افغانستان خارج میکنن افغان ها با این مشکل ندارن اما افغان ها کمک های امریکا را و جامعه جهانی را تا به سال های بعدی هم خواهان هستند به خاطر از اینکه افغانستان در یک بحران اقتصادی به سر میبره
peace negotiations between representatives of the Afghan government and the Taliban commenced in Qatar on 12 September, after more than 6 months of delay amid political dysfunction in Kabul and continued conflict. Since then, talks have only inched forward and fighting in many parts of Afghanistan has escalated. Negotiators spent 3 months reaching agreement on a mere three-page set of procedures for the talks and were just beginning to discuss what substantive topics to put on their agenda when they took a weeks-long break. With Taliban violence on the rise and the Afghan government struggling to manage multi-dimensional security and political challenges, it is far from clear where negotiations are headed. Few observers are also of the view that China and Russia are looking for an opportunity in the political vacuum post-US withdrawal and they might take the virtual control. In such a scenario, the challenge for Biden administration is only growing bigger. And with beleaguered Afghans' hopes set on Biden, the task is going to nothing short of enormous.
Moving on. The Sindhi ethnic community in Pakistan has intensified its demands of freedom from the clutches of Islamabad. In a unique demonstration organized on the 117th birth anniversary of GM Syed, the father of Sindhi nationalism, they flashed placards of the world leaders who they have urged to come to their rescue. Sindhis say Pakistan has been carrying out systematic human rights violations, economic depredations, and an everyday discrimination in their region.
Streets of Sun, a small village in Pakistan's Sindh province, were swept by anti-establishment demonstrations as a large number of them gathered to demand independence. In the first of its kind demonstration, the protesters held banners of US President Joe Biden, Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi, British PM Boris Johnson, UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres, and other renowned leaders of the world, asking them to intervene in the rapidly deteriorating human rights situation in Sindh. Sindhis accuse Pakistan of persecuting them, with their land and resources being exploited indiscriminately and their culture enduring a state-backed ethnic cleansing attempt.
Hamara ye mauqif raha hai tareekhi taur par ke Sindhu desh Sindhi qoum ka tareekhi watan hai jisko Pakistan ke naam par Punjab ke मजहब के नाम पर नफसियाती हुरबे और पंजाबी फौज की बंदूक के जोर पर जबरन गुलाम किया गया है। सिंध सिंधियों का तारीखी वतन रहा है। सिंधी हम तारीखी तौर पर एक कौम है जिस कौम को 1947 में बंदूक और मजहबी हरबे के बुनियाद पर पंजाबी साम्राज्य ने गुलाम बनाया हुआ है।
The Sindh population, which comprises mainly of minorities and muhajirs, say that Pakistan administration does not consider them at par with the other citizens of the country. While Punjabis are treated as elites in all domains of the society, they face acute discrimination and marginalization. Their demands for rights are suppressed through one or the other means. Reasonable voices of their movement have been muzzled with high-handedness. The government has launched a crackdown against everyone it deems potent of rising for freedom. A number of them have been picked and detained indefinitely without trial. The family members have no idea where their close ones are. While the government refrains from providing any real data of those who have been abducted and killed, even a quick peek into the social media accounts of Sindhis speaks everything about the atrocities these people are bearing on everyday basis.
The situation in Sindh is getting day by day worse and worse. because we suffer from slavery and Pakistani occupied forces are making this slavery strong and strong, and suppression is every day is going on. Huge numbers of people have disappeared, political activists, human rights activists, human rights defenders, journalists, everybody is target. Whoever they feel that is a dissent, they don't agree with their ideology, they are under attack, they are disappeared, and people have been harassed every day. Not, I don't think so, a single political activist or a single family in Sindh which is spared from this harassment from the Pakistani agencies.
Activists have started calling it an international issue because they say it's not just Pakistan that is bent at destroying their lives and livelihood, but China too is a major stakeholder in crimes against them. China has invested around $70 billion in Pakistan and now influences almost every domestic and external policy of the country. After Balochistan and illegally occupied POK and Gilgit-Baltistan, it is after Sindh for its strategic advancements. Islamabad has been obliging its orders. Critics say Beijing's wishes have been fulfilled promptly. Despite strong opposition, two islands, Bandal and Baddo, were taken under Pakistan's control through an ordnance route. The alacrity was shown because China needs it for its CPEC corridor. As per the terms, even the judiciary cannot interfere. Objections have been dismissed or suppressed. Local leaders say this is the beginning of their end. Pakistan will sell everything in Sindh to China, and the residents will not have many options except migrating to even more hostile places or perish in abject poverty and deprivation.
Moving on. POK and Gilgit-Baltistan are the two most deprived territories on the planet. They are being exploited and marginalized. Human rights violations have been normalized by the state. However, the people say they are not ready to endure it anymore. Recently, they took on the police and retaliated with force after the law enforcement agencies charged their anti-inflation demonstration with batons and tear gas shells.
Clashes between the civilians and police broke out in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir after a protest against rising inflation turned violent following the arrest of the local leaders. The protest was organized by the Action Committee in Ravlakot against the removal of subsidy on wheat flour. However, the police arrested local leaders before the planned protest, which triggered anger among the residents. The angry protesters clashed with the police and set ablaze a police station and destroyed police vehicles in the Azad Patan area. Police carried out firing, baton-charged protesters, injuring several of them.
जो गिरफ्तारियां हुई हैं, जिस पर शीर साहब ने तफसीलन बात रख दी है, हम समझते हैं वो एक हथकंडा है इंतजामिया की तरफ से, वो ये हथकंडा है कि हमारी तहरीक को पुरशदत करने की एक साजिश है, जो कि हम बार बार कह रहे हैं कि तहरीक पुरअमन तहरीक है, वो इंसानी बुनियादी मसाइल पर बनने वाली तहरीक है, वो आटे के उसूल के लिए तहरीक है, वो महंगाई बेरोजगारी के खिलाफ तहरीक है, वो तालीम के उसूल के लिए तहरीक है। तो बाबा आप देख सकते हैं कि ये इंसानिया ये रियासत आए दिन जो भी बुनियादी इंसानी हकूक की लड़ाई लड़ रहा है उस पर तरह तरह के फतवे दे रहे हैं और शद्दत और जबर कर रहे हैं। हम मजम्मत करते हैं आज के जो हमारे दोस्त एक्शन कमेटी रावला कोर्ट के जो दोस्त जो अनाउंसमेंट कर रहे थे कल के हवाले से तहशीर कर रहे थे, तो मैं समझता हूँ कि उनका क्या गुनाह है।
Locals claim that this is a regular feature in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir and the Pakistan government abused them at the pretext of security. The law enforcement agencies have been carrying out atrocities with impunity. People have become saturated with widespread discrimination and persecution. Their living standards too have deteriorated significantly with time. There have been protests for the past several weeks against skyrocketing inflation, but the local government and Islamabad are paying no heed to their concerns.
Festivals in India are at the heart of people's lives. This in itself showcases the glory of celebrations in the country. It has given birth to an ethos where people come together and celebrate every festival with much zeal and vigor. Similar scenes were witnessed during the 354th birth anniversary of the 10th and the last spiritual leader of Sikhism, Guru Gobind Singh, which was celebrated with great fervor and splendor in the country. Let's have a look.
A large number of Sikh devotees from across the Indian states visited the holiest Sikh shrine, the Golden Temple, in India's Amritsar city to mark the 354th birth anniversary of the 10th and the last spiritual leader of Sikhism, Guru Gobind Singh. The Guru's birth anniversary, also known as Guru Parv, is celebrated every year as an occasion to remember the brave deeds of Guru Gobind Singh, who organized Sikhs to protect the community's beliefs in the 17th century during the Mughal rule. Devotees participated in the religious procession Nagar Kirtan, which was marked by carrying of the holy book Guru Granth Sahib in a decorated floral palanquin. The Gurudwara donned a festive look both from inside and outside, where devotees were seen offering special prayers, seeking blessings and recollecting the teachings of the Guru.
ਬਹੁਤ ਦੂਰੋਂ ਦੂਰੋਂ ਜੀ ਦੇਸ਼ਾਂ ਵਿਦੇਸ਼ਾਂ ਤੋਂ ਵੀ ਸੰਗਤਾਂ ਇਸ ਨਗਰ ਕੀਰਤਨ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਆ ਕੇ ਖੁਸ਼ੀਆਂ ਆਨੰਦ ਮਾਣ ਰਹੇ ਆ ਜੀ। ਕੱਲ੍ਹ ਗੁਰੂ ਗੋਬਿੰਦ ਸਿੰਘ ਜੀ ਦਾ ਅਵਤਾਰ ਗੁਰਪੁਰਬ ਆ ਜੀ। ਇਸ ਦੇ ਸੰਬੰਧ ਵਿੱਚ ਕੱਲ੍ਹ ਰਾਤ ਹਰਿਮੰਦਰ ਸਾਹਿਬ ਵਿੱਚ ਦੀਪਮਾਲਾ ਅਤੇ ਅਸ਼ਤਬਾਜੀ ਵੀ ਕੀਤੀ ਜਾਏਗੀ ਜੀ।
The scene was no different at Bihar's capital Patna, where Patna Sahib Gurudwara was illuminated with beautiful lights. Patna Sahib Gurudwara, which is believed to be the birthplace of Sikh Guru, saw a crowd of thousands of people who came from different Indian states to be a part of this grand celebration of Prakash Utsav. On this day, Gurudwaras around the country offer free meals to devotees and to visitors in the form of langar to mark the motto of service before self as propagated by Guru Gobind Singh.
देश विदेश से हजारों की संख्या में यहाँ पर दर्शनार्थी आ रहे हैं, लेकिन सरकार द्वारा जो कोरोना को लेकर दिशा निर्देश दी गई है उसको पालन करते हुए गुरुद्वारा प्रबंधक कमेटी इस आयोजन में लगे हुए हैं, और जो भी यात्रियाँ हैं उनकी ठहरने की, लंगर का, यातायात का बहुत अच्छा प्रबंध किया गया है।
Each year, the festival is marked with large processions, devotional songs, devotees performing martial arts and lights, and a joy, which is why the festival is also known as Prakash Parv. The holy occasion was wrapped up with colorful and sparkling multicolored light of fireworks.
Guru Gobind Singh is the 10th Sikh Guru, a warrior, poet, philosopher and son of the revered 9th Sikh Guru Tegh Bahadur, who founded the Sikh warrior community Khalsa in the late 17th century. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye, take care and stay safe.